The next item of business is a statement by Fergus Ewing on common agricultural payments. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement. Therefore, there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, first I pay tribute to my predecessor, Richard Lockhead. For 9 years, he served rural Scotland as its champion, tireless in his work in promoting our high-quality food and drink and in standing up for Scotland's interests in fishing and farming here in London and in Brussels. I and the whole Chamber will wish him and his family well. Let me say at the outset, Presiding Officer, that the CAP payment scheme has caused amongst the farming and crofting communities and businesses in Scotland anger, frustration, hardship and cost. As someone who has represented for 17 years a constituency with vital farming and crofting interests, I'm very well aware of that. And I want to start off with three simple words addressed by me on behalf of the Scottish Government to all farmers and crofters who have suffered as a result. We are sorry. And let me follow it up with four further words. We are fixing it. Progress has been made. And now, Presiding Officer, I can say that most farmers and crofters should have received most of their due payment. By the end of April past, all eligible farmers should have received a substantial payment from the government unless they chose to opt out of the nationally funded loan scheme. That payment will have been worth around 80% of their estimated entitlement. We recognise the industry's need for cash flow. We did not meet our targets and we accepted that created problems for businesses. We were determined to get cash out to farmers and crofters, and for that reason we put the nationally funded loan scheme in place. But if any members' constituents believe that they are eligible for the basic payment scheme and have not received a payment, please ask them to contact their area office and we shall ensure that we establish what the position is with their claim. We paid out over 5,000 national BPS loans in April, worth over £90 million. Over 40% of these, Presiding Officer, have been repaid already, as the main EU-funded payments have been processed. And at present, we have made main EU-funded basic and greening payments to over 15,000 businesses, which is over 84% of eligible farmers and crofters. Payments made totalling almost £200 million. Those farmers will be due further payments when we have finalised their entitlements worth around £50 million. And a further 3,000 plus farmers and crofters who have already been offered national loans need to receive their main payments, totalling up to £95 million. We also expect soon to start payments under the coupled support scheme for sheep and to complete payments under the two schemes for beef cattle, Pillar 1 schemes, which are also subject to the EU's direct payments deadline. The government is doing everything possible to get those payments out before the end of June. The Auditor General's report was published a week past Thursday, and we accept that it contains very serious criticisms. This, the Audit Scotland's third report, sets out recommendations which we are considering very carefully and to all of which we shall, in due course, respond. The resolution of the CAP problems will not be achieved overnight, nor by any single or simple set of actions. But I believe that we shall substantially resolve these difficulties and pledge to all that this will be my first and foremost priority in my new role to bring about that resolution. Commissioner Hogan confirmed that a number of member states across Europe are facing problems with the ambitious timetable for the new Common Agricultural Policy. The Audit Scotland report noted that this timetable presented a challenge along with the complexity of the European policy and the additional features requested by the Scottish farming industry. And this has lain at the heart of the difficulties that we have faced. Payment performance this year has fallen short of the very high standards that the government has delivered in recent years. Of course, the government had already acknowledged these difficulties to Parliament as long ago as autumn 2014, in evidence to the Public Audit Committee. The government had accepted that the size of the task was massively underestimated at the start. And the time needed to recover from the start had left the government with a huge challenge in meeting the CAP deadlines. But, as I've already said, we are fixing this. Presiding Officer, I have three objectives. First, to complete the 2015 payments so farmers get their money as soon as possible. Second, to deliver compliance and minimise any financial penalties. And third, to see the 2016 payments placed on a proper footing. I'm pleased to report that there are positive signs within the programme. Area office staff reported to me that they're making better progress. We have reduced costs. Since January, Presiding Officer, we have saved over £1.2 million on contractor reductions, and this remains a key priority to deliver further savings. We've improved IT delivery. However, we must be realistic. I'm determined that for the 2016 payments, we make clear to Parliament and to the farming industry what the likely timescales really look like. The farming industry needs to have confidence in the payment timetable and that we will do what we say. There must be no repeat of the problems faced in 2015-16. I'm also conscious that the Auditor General raised concerns about the budget for the programme. We accept that there are risks, but we are bearing down on all aspects of the spend and taking every opportunity to mitigate this risk further. I'm determined that the government learn the lessons from the Futures programme, not just for the remainder of this programme, but also for our wider portfolio of IT programmes. But I don't wish to detract, Presiding Officer, from the clear and present task of getting the last of the payments out to farmers and crofters. Now is the time to focus on that and on meeting the payment deadline successfully. But I can tell you now that there will be a process to learn lessons from this experience. I will return to Parliament in the autumn with more details on our progress on the three objectives that I have outlined. Presiding Officer, from day one in the job and for the foreseeable future, the resolution of the CAP payment issues are my top priority as Cabinet Secretary. I want to assure members and all listening in the rural communities of Scotland of this, that I will devote all necessary time and attention to that task. It is my number one priority, and let me give the Chamber this categoric assurance. I am determined to oversee and drive forward the work necessary to bring this payment regime back onto an even keel.
Can I thank Mr. Ewing? I'm intending to allow 20 minutes for questions to the Cabinet Secretary. Would members who wish to ask a question please press the request to speak button first. I call on Peter Chapman to ask the first question. Mr. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am grateful to the Minister for making this statement to the Chamber today and for providing an advance copy of his statement. However, these apologetic words do nothing to make up for the months of chaos and heartbreak in our rural economy that his department has caused. Time and time again over the past 6 months, government ministers have had to come to this chamber and explain that they need more time to get payments out. That simply is unacceptable. And it has completely eroded farmers' trust in this government. In order to regain that trust, I hope that the Minister will today commit to all payments being with farmers and crofters by the end of June. This deadline is important not only because of how vital this money is to farmers, but also because unless 95% is paid by this date, the government will be liable for fines from the EU of up to £125 million. So, will the government today commit to getting these payments out in time?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can assure the member that I do appreciate the serious consequences that have been caused by this matter, and I alluded to that and accepted that in my statement. And I provided absolute reassurance that everything possible being done to make in full the 2015 payments as quickly as possible is being done. At present, we have made payments equivalent to 84% of the applications under the Basic Payment Scheme and Greening. As the member will know, there are Pillar 1 and Pillar 2 payments, and the Pillar 2 payments, many of which are not actually to be completed by the end of June anyway. They're not subject to the same deadline. So it's not, with respect, quite as simple as saying that every single payment be made by 30th of June. As the member will know very well, there are other aspects of it which do not comply with that deadline. But, so far as that deadline is concerned, having visited two of the area offices last Monday, having spent 3 hours this morning before Cabinet in detailed discussions and meeting with the teams who are dealing with the farmers, I know that many of the people in that area office are of and from the farming community. They have the respect and trust of the farming community. They are part of it. And therefore, I think we want to support the excellent work they do and boost their morale at this time, and not subject them to undue criticism when they are busting a gut to complete the job, presiding officer, and I fully support them in the work that they're doing.
Rhoda Grant, to be followed by Michael Russell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the early sight of the statement and also congratulate him on his new post. This whole scheme has been shambolic and there's been a lack of information and many missed deadlines. In the run-up to the election, we had a Cabinet Secretary that spent his time trawling his old personnel files rather than ensuring our farmers and crofters were being paid. Therefore, priority must be given to getting the correct payments to them, those that are still waiting, because there has been genuine hardship caused by these delays and it needs to be dealt with. Given his answer to the last question, can he now give a realistic timescale for full payment? He will also be aware that people have received payments that they're not entitled to, and others have received payments that they declined. Will individual circumstances be taken into account when this money is being clawed back?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I can assure Rhoda Grant that the whole efforts of everybody in the department are devoted to the task of timeous payment of the remainder of the payments. And having devoted some of my own time over the past days since my appointment to updating myself, I can assure the member that a huge amount of work is being done and that substantial progress is being made week on week. That figure of 84% is much higher than it was a couple of weeks ago. Week on week, considerable progress is being made. The absolute priority is not to be distracted by other matters at the present time, not to be distracted by recriminations or the right need to learn lessons at some time in the future, but to allow the people who are doing the job to complete their job and to do that job with the confidence of their elected representatives. And I would make a plea to Ms. Grant and to all her colleagues, because she mentions problems in relation to payments. And this, is, she knows, is not new. It's a systemic problem in respect of the CAP system, where some of the penalties exacted for relatively minor errors do seem to be pretty swinging in relation to the individual cases that we've all seen as MSPs. So I would make this plea to Rhoda Grant and all other members. If there are any individual cases, presiding officer, facing hardship, or who feel, as Ms. Grant has alluded to, that mistakes have been made, they should contact their area offices forthwith. And I will be writing to each member with full contact details of each of the 16 area offices in Scotland and of the helpline staff, whom I also spoke to this morning, and who were busily handling inquiries from farmers at that time. So I do hope members will focus not on recrimination, but on implementation of the system, supporting the excellent work of all of the people, hundreds of people around this country that are determined to do right by the farming community.
Michael Russell, to be followed by John Lamont.
I'm sure everybody will welcome the work that the Cabinet Secretary has been doing to take forward this issue and to ensure that the hard work being done in the area offices is paying fruit. Can I address two very simple questions to him? Firstly, in terms of future practice, what work is being done to ensure that payments can be made in the next round without undue delay, and particularly at the start of the opening of the payment window in December? And secondly, what thoughts has he given to the type of investigation that will be required at some stage in the future to ensure that this cannot happen again, and to give confidence to the farming and crofting community that the lessons have indeed been learned?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, to take the second question first, as I stated in my opening remarks, Presiding Officer, it is essential that we learn lessons, and therefore I stated that it is my intention, with permission of the appropriate authorities, to come back to this chamber to provide an update in the autumn, after which, of course, the deadline of the 30th June will have passed, and we will have had the opportunity to carry out all relevant analysis as to how matters are at that point. So I undertake that when I come back to Parliament, I will set out in detail the response to the member's question in relation to how best we learn lessons, and so that we do not see a repetition of the problems which have arisen. Turning to his first question, the difficulties with the 2015 payments have had a knock-on effect with the 2016 payments, and indeed those who have read Carolyn Gardner's report will have noted that. And one of the obvious difficulties is that time spent, for example, right now out doing inspections for 2016 applications in the fields are being spent in the office dealing with the 2015 payments. However, on a positive note, I can reassure the House that the process involved in the processing of the 2016 applications has gone pretty well, and it has gone much more smoothly and with much less IT difficulty than the 2015 application process had at this time. In other words, progress is being made, Presiding Officer, but there are still a large number of practicalities to answer Mr. Russell's question that we have to deal with. And to allow us to do that is partly why I think it prudent to state that I come back to give more precise details about the 2016 payment profile in the autumn.
John Lamont to be followed by Graham Day. Mr. Lamont.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Borders normally receives some £50 million of CAP payments. This money not only benefits farmers, but it filters down to many other businesses, and the delays are causing problems for the whole rural economy. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell me what percentage of the total money due to Borders farmers has actually been received to date?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, that is not regionalised information, such as that is not information that I have before me. I did have the pleasure of visiting the Dumfries area office last Monday, which administers a huge part of the south of Scotland. I'm not certain that the information can be readily provided, but I undertake to write to the member on that matter. I'm not sure that I recognise the figure of 50 million as not being paid to Borders farmers. Perhaps he could send me a computation of how that's made up. I would reiterate that we have made payment of 84% of applications, amounting to nearly £200 million. And I want to stress this, Presiding Officer, because it's not the case that we've made zero payments and all farmers are waiting for the money. That is the opposite of the case. Most farmers have received most payments. Now, that is in no way to say that it's acceptable that farmers are waiting for payments in many, many cases. It is not. But the position is that we have seen 84% of applications having been dealt with and nearly £200 million paid. And if I may say so, a loan scheme which was operated, from information I got this morning, with great success, very efficiently. So I commend the public servants in this country for the excellent work they're doing. And I hope that's the sentiment that other members will start to echo.
Graham Deed to be followed by Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, constituents of mine have highlighted to me an issue which appears to have contributed to the delay in their receiving payments, which was the identifying of very small parts of their land as Region 2 when the rest was entirely Region 1. In one case, a constituent had a tiny section of wood deemed to be Region 2 and the remainder was Region 1. Can I ask whether this sort of experience was widespread and how it will be resolved ahead of the 2016 payments?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, well, I'm very happy to look at that individual case. If Mr. Day wishes to raise it with me, I understand from his description that in Region 1 there may be arable land and in Region 2, in this case, rough grazing. And that means, of course, that in an individual application there can be a number of complexities, and it does illustrate the challenges that the system faced. For example, there are 4 million hectares subject to the basic payment scheme in Scotland, 400,000 fields. Each field is on average 4 or 5 times the size of a football pitch. The degree of accuracy which the EU requires for audit purposes is the size of a goal mouth. And if you think about it, therefore, 400,000 checks, 400,000 fields, very small margin for error, you start to appreciate the mammoth task that was faced in converting a manual system to an IT system. That is not in any way to write off or minimise the difficulties. It's a matter of fact. And it's perhaps why also down south in England and in France, they have had many, many of similar difficulties.
Claudia Beamish, followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Labour has called for a review of the payment process. Will this be forthcoming and with maximum transparency? And will the Cabinet Secretary be able to guarantee that applications for next year will meet the appropriate timescales with some additional support for farmers in view of the debacle this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the payment window in 2016 is 1st December to 30th of June, and obviously we want to make timeous payment. I have already said in response to Claudia Beamish in respect to her second question that I will come back in the autumn and at that point give as precise information as I can. In response to her first question, where she used the word review, I've already said also, I believe to be fair to myself, Presiding Officer, that I will come back again and set out in detail what we propose in order to ensure that we learn the lessons. So I assume Claudia Beamish is pleased with that forthright answer.
Mark Ruskell to be followed by Stuart Simpson. Mr. Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of the statement? And I was thinking about Robert Burns, of course, Ayrshire farmer, who said, there is no such uncertainty as a sure thing. Now, it's the role of government here to provide certainty, particularly for a sector which is dogged by uncertainty from year to year. That's not to say that things can't go wrong. Clearly, something has gone catastrophically wrong with this payment. But communication is absolutely key. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, will he ensure that this chamber is given weekly updates along with key stakeholders about the remaining process for 2015, including information about the applications made, the mapping process that backs up the applications process, the regionalisation process, the work that's been done on the entitlement rate, and also payments that are being made under the National Reserve?
Cabinet Secretary.
When Ms. Ruskell was saying he was going to quote Burns, I was a bit anxious that he may quote from To a Louse, but fortunately he didn't go down that particular road. I think the request for information is perfectly reasonable. We want to be transparent and open. I will reflect on his question. I think a weekly schedule would be a bit much, frankly, and would impose too much of a burden on the very people who are leading the task. But I think in principle his view is correct. It's also one of the leading points in the NFU manifesto. So I think I'm in favour of that in principle, and I will write to the member once I've given thought to what further information is available. And with that letter, I will of course pass on the details of each of the area offices, which I hope all members will use to pass on inquiries from constituents who may have concerns in order to ensure the swiftest possible resolution of them.
Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Douglas Ross. Mr. Stevenson.
Can I draw members' attention to my joint ownership of a registered agricultural holding, which is let to my neighbour for rough grazing? I receive no financial reward for so doing. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware, having sat on the Parliamentary Committee that looked at the IT difficulties in the SQA programme under the Labour-Liberal administration in 2000, could be aware perhaps of the London Ambulance Service IT failures in 1992 under the Conservatives. We're now dealing with a project that had significant IT failures associated with it under this administration. Can he indicate how the public sector in general can raise its game in the way that it uses IT for public benefit?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm not responsible for all IT systems across the government. That's a somewhat pleasing reflection to offer the Chamber. But, of course, he's perfectly right to say that, and I'm sure he's referring to this, Caroline Gardner, in her third report on the cap payment system, did say that she is reflecting on general lessons to be learned and will let us have our views shortly. So in that respect, I think perhaps the most sensible answer I can give to Mr. Stevenson, who I didn't appreciate now, so was a farmer amongst his many other occupations. but not a huge surprise, I have to say, Mr. Stevenson. But I will reflect on his remarks and would urge him to await the publication of the further thoughts of Carolyn Gardner on these matters.
Douglas Ross, to be followed by Mike Rumbles. Mr. Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary said in his statement that he will return to Parliament in the autumn. That's simply not good enough. The farming community cannot wait that long. Now, he has said that he will reflect on weekly updates, so could I ask if the Cabinet Secretary will give an assurance to return to this chamber on the 30th of June, the EU deadline date, and also our last sitting day before the recess, to update Parliament on whether any farmers or crofters in Moray, the Highlands and Islands, or across Scotland are still waiting any of their entitlement. The Parliament and rural communities deserve to know if the Scottish Government will miss the EU deadline and if taxpayers will have to bear the brunt of a fine of up to £125 million.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, in response to Mr. Ross, let me say that were I to say that I will come and make a statement on the 30th of June, that's the day of the deadline. In order to make that statement, and Mr. Ross hasn't been in this place for long, what it would be necessary to do would be to disrupt the work of officials just at the very time when they're trying to complete the task that we all want them to do. Yeah. So, really, of course I will update this House as soon as I possibly can. But what I will not do, and what I may say, Presiding Officer, I do not think farmers want us to do is A, play a blame game prematurely, and B, detract our attention from the object of getting the final payments out to them. That's what farmers want, at least the ones I have spoken to, and I've already met with the NFU president and had a visit to John Kinnaird's farm, a recently former NFU president. Farmers want to get it sorted out. They don't want to see a game of political partisan blame ascription. They want to get it sorted out and put on an even keel, and that's what I've committed to do. That's what this government will do.
Mike Rumbles, be followed by Ian Green. Mr. Rumbles.
I thank the Minister for the advance notice of his statement and also indeed for the briefing last week for opposition spokespeople on this. And I've got no doubt that his clearing up the mess of his predecessor is indeed his number one priority. However, at that same briefing, his civil servant said, and I quote, that they had far from given up hope, unquote, of completing the necessary payments to our farmers by the end of June. Now that, to me, doesn't sound reassuring, despite what the Minister has already said to many members this afternoon. And if the Minister fails to complete the payments, as Douglas Ross said just a moment ago, we do face £125 million fine in non-compliance fines. I want to ask him, how confident is he that he will meet those deadlines and not be hit by the fines?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm pleased that Mr. Rumbles found the briefing that I provided for opposition MSPs useful. It is, incidentally, the way I try to do things and provide to opposition MSPs access to an informal briefing, including with lead civil servants, so that they have an opportunity to inform themselves of the issues. And that's the normal practice that I seek to follow, Presiding Officer. To answer his question, I'm absolutely confident that everything possible is being done to meet the 30th of June deadline. And the whole of my efforts are devoted to securing that objective.
Ian Gray to be followed by Bruce Crawford. Mr. Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I appreciate the Cabinet Secretary saying that he's doing everything possible to get the payments out the door, but he cannot escape the fact that if he does not achieve 95% of the direct payments out and compliant before the deadline, he does face financial penalties estimated by Audit Scotland at between £40 and £125 million. So what contingency has the Cabinet Secretary made, and from which budget would any such penalties have to be found?
Cabinet Secretary.
Obviously our efforts are devoted entirely to minimising any conceivable penalty. The member is quite right in the figures that he's quoted from the Auditor General's report. I have already made public the fact that my predecessor, Richard Lockhead, made very substantial efforts, extremely substantial efforts, in carrying out sensible and helpful work in making representations to the EU Commission to allow the deadline of 30th of June to be extended. I think it's right that Richard Lockhead should get some credit for the work he actually did. And he did that work. It was good work. It was sensible. And I remain hopeful that the EU Commission, as a result of Richard Lochhead's sensible, worthwhile and detailed and protracted negotiations, may still provide us with more time than the 30th of June. But it is certainly a challenging deadline. I have made no bones about that. And in relation to financial contingencies, I've already explained that the National Loan Scheme, which we instituted, has been tremendously successful. If you think about it, loans paid to over 5,000 people in April, paid to the extent of 50% by now, is a tremendous effort, and I expect that it will be a very successful and professionally conducted exercise when I come back to the House in the autumn and report further. I may also say that down south in England, they have used a loan scheme as well. And I should add that in other EU states, including France, which has been published, and many other states whose names have not been published, perhaps out of understandable reticence, there have been similar difficulties. This is not unique to Scotland. And lastly, in relation to penalties, which was the main thrust of Mr. Gray's question, over a 10-year period, I'm informed that that payments in England have sustained or resulted in penalties approximating to over £600 million. So I think we will look at the issue of contingencies as and when required, and I've already had detailed discussions with the Finance Secretary in relation to the overall financial consequences of the scheme. But I think it's fair for me to say that we will come back and answer questions such as that if they arise, and most certainly by the autumn.
And final brief question to Bruce Crawford.
Thank you, President Officer, for allowing me in, given the time. Could the Cabinet Secretary outline what discussions he has had with farmers and other stakeholders involved in the workings of the CAP payment scheme since his appointment? And I wonder if in future he would make the dairy industry a priority on this matter, given the great price of milk continues to fall in this hard-pressed sector.
I'm glad Mr. Crawford mentioned that. I'm well aware of the pressures on the farming in general and the dairy sector in particular. In response to his question, I did have the pleasure of meeting in my new official capacity with Alan Bowie, the president of the NFU, and Scott Walker as chief executive. And I also have had a very enjoyable visit to Johnny Kinnaird's farm last week. And tomorrow, I look forward to spending several hours at Scott Sheep.